Well, a warm welcome to everyone. It's good to see you. It's lovely to have someone new in as well, so welcome. It's good to have you with us. A number of our folks, some are coming, some are injured after the picnic this afternoon, but we're not going to go there. But let's pray God's blessing on this service this evening. Just wait a moment. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all your love and your kindness to us this day. We thank you that this is the day that you have made. And Lord, we can come and meet with you, meet with your people, and praise and worship you. Lord, we know we can praise and worship you on our own, Lord, but it's so great to be able to sing together, to be able to hear your word, and to be able to just be together as we would worship you together. And so, Lord, we come to you now and would pray that you would meet with us, that you would deal with us, whether we are here in the church building or we're watching online. And we pray, Lord, that you would meet with us and that you would do us all good by giving us a real blessing. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll start by singing an older hymn, I'll Praise My Maker. We're going to be reading from Jonah chapter 4. We read the whole of the chapter. So Jonah chapter 4. But Jonah was greatly displeased, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "O Lord, is this not what I said when I was still at home? That is why I was so quick to flee to Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, O Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live." But the Lord replied, "Have you any right to be angry?" Jonah went out and sat down at a place east of the city. There he made himself a shelter, sat in its shade, and waited to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord God provided a vine and made it grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the vine. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm, which chewed the vine so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind, and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die and said, "It would be better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Do you have a right to be angry about the vine?" "I do," he said. "I'm angry enough to die." But the Lord said, "You've been concerned about this vine, though you did not tend it or make it grow. It sprang up overnight and died overnight. But Nineveh has more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and many cattle as well. Should I not be concerned about that great city?" We see some of the Lord's compassion there in those closing verses, but we're not dealing with those tonight. But anyway, yeah, I'm looking forward to dealing with those. But let's come to our God in prayer now. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a God who is compassionate and slow to anger. Lord, that you do not treat us as our sins deserve. Otherwise, Lord, we'd be blotted off from the face of the earth. We'd be vaporized, Lord, because we do so much to anger you, to offend you, Lord. Even as your children, we confess that we are prone to wander, prone to leave the God we love. Lord, we pray that our hearts would be taken and sealed from your courts above with a love, with a passion, with a delight for you, Lord, and the things of God. Oh, help us to realize how wonderful our God is. Our God is an awesome God, a great God. Lord, he's the God of gods. Lord, he is the glorious one. And yet, Lord, we are little creatures on earth, and we're feeble and frail. And Lord, we can yet praise you for that. Praise you that we're able, because of your mercy and your grace, that we can sing praises to our great God, to our Father in heaven, to our Savior who's there. Lord, we can praise you for all the benefits and all the blessings that you've heaped upon us in our lives. And even now in these trying, these difficult COVID times, Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you are granting wisdom to scientists, to doctors, to nurses, Lord, to research people, and Lord, that they're able to provide this amazing vaccine, Lord. And we pray that you would continue to help people to use it wisely, Lord, that we would be wise in it as well, and that, Lord, that you would continue to watch over us. You would watch over not only our nation, Lord, but worldwide, that you would grant wisdom and grace and understanding to governments how best to distribute, how best to control the spread of this, how to distribute the vaccines, and how to best to control the spread of the virus as well, Lord. Lord, many places are trying different approaches, and Lord, it's amazing how easily things go wrong, and we pray for wisdom in our own land, when to put the brakes on, when to ease up, Lord. And so we pray for the NHS, we pray for all those who are involved in things, Lord, and caring for so many people, as we prayed this morning for the need for test tubes, for blood samples, Lord, and that we're going to be many millions short. We pray for the supply chain, Lord, for the manufacturers. Pray for resourcing of these things throughout the world, that it would be a fair distribution for those in need. And so, Lord, we pray for wisdom ahead for the four nations of the United Kingdom, as they would each take a different approach at different times. And so, Lord, we ask for wisdom from above. We do pray for our governments, Lord, and we pray for our national government as well as our different country parliaments, Lord, or assemblies, Lord, and that you would continue to help them and grant them wisdom, Lord, not out of a bias, not out of a political gainsay, but for the good of the people of this land. Lord, we pray that same prayer for other lands, that people would be, politicians would be working well, working together to safeguard their people. But Lord, we come to you now and we pray that you would continue to be with us. We've given thanks this morning for those who we know have had blessings and encouragement through their health and test results, Lord. I forgot to give thanks for Alistair and Anna, Anna's recovery after this operation, and pray that after all this loss of blood she's had, that she'd be able to recover there in Nairobi. We thank you that the children have been flown down and safely arrived in Nairobi from South Sudan, and would pray for them as a family that it would be a good time just spending time together away from the compound. But we pray for the MAF compound, Lord, and the need of Alistair to be back there flying planes to help missionaries, to help doctors, nurses, and different places, Lord, with supplies. We pray for much wisdom for them. So, Lord, continue to be with them. But be with us now, Lord. We're going to look at your word, and we pray that your word would look at us, but also encourage us and build us up in our walk of faith as we go on with you. And so, great God, come amongst us and meet with us both here in church and those watching online too. We ask it for your glory and for your honor. Amen. It's good, isn't it? I can't even see where I put the sermon. Right, no sermon tonight. That was a real encouragement. No one cheered. So. Oh well, it's paper notes. Sorry about that. Chaos reigns. Last time when we continued looking at Jonah, and we got to chapter 4, we noticed in verse 1, Jonah's resentment. You know how we saw how he was greatly angry, and we considered some of the reasons of his resentment. There's a problem with his reputation. If Nineveh wasn't destroyed, he could be called a false prophet and even stoned by his own people when he went back to them. And then he saw also the problem of God's honor, that God had said this was going to happen, it wasn't happening, and people could have mocked God. And this was intertwined with God not honoring Jonah's ministry. And we saw how Jonah became resentful, and yet amazingly, he was a man of God. He'd been a prophet. He'd been greatly used by God at different times. He had recently been shown much of God's grace personally, as he spared from the watery grave, and then he spared from the belly of the fish, as we'll call it. And God is doing amazing things in him. And then he's sent to Nineveh, and he goes, and he preaches. And must have been a hard-hearted preacher to have preached and then said, well, I don't want any effect. I don't want my preaching to affect anyone's life, and I just want this city destroyed. But you see that Jonah resented God working in grace and mercy in Nineveh. The same grace, the same pardon, the same mercy that was shown to him. He didn't want it shown to the Ninevites, and he's a contradiction of a preacher. That he's hard-hearted against the ones that he was preaching to. Jonah didn't want them saved. This was the last thing he wanted the people to do. And he noted, we noted that Jonah is not to be thought of a one-off. My notes are all in a different place because I'm used to using the Kindle. But Jonah is not a one-off. He's typical of any believer. We can be like that. We can be like that to a greater or lesser extent. We can be angry with God. We can resent him working in our lives. or even in the lives of other people, God blessing them. Why are they being blessed when I work harder and I pray harder and I study harder, I do this, that, and the other, and yet they're being blessed and they're seeing success or whatever? We can resent God's blessing, promoting or providing for those who we feel don't deserve it. They shouldn't have that. This should be for me. Perhaps the more common form of resenting God's work in our lives is when some tragedy, when some sickness or some loss in terms of a family member or we're affected in some way that comes upon us and those we know and love, and we can't understand it. God, I've been praying for the family, I've been praying for this, and yet they're getting worse or things are going pear-shaped in our lives. Jonah resented God showing mercy, God sparing Nineveh. But his anger didn't stop there, because we have recorded for us, and this is where we start what we're looking at this evening, verse 2, we see Jonah's complaint. Here we do see Jonah the moaner, and he's belly aching here. Things had gone not as he'd expected or imagined, and he gave vent to his resentment, and he mourns, he complains before God. I think we get the idea. It upset Jonah. It got up his nose. It annoyed him thoroughly. It irritated him that God hadn't destroyed Nineveh and its 120,000 or more inhabitants. It's an amazing, it's frightening how Jonah, who's sent to preach this message of warning, can suddenly sink into such rebellion against God. And he's complaining to God. Don't forget that. He's moaning to God about this situation, especially in the light of all that God had done for him, how God had spared him when he rebelled and ran away. And God had dealt marvelously with him just a short time previously. And Jonah knew many great truths about God. As we see, we noted it in the prayer that he prayed in the belly of the fish. He knew that salvation came from God alone. That's a great thought. That God is the only God who can truly save people. He trusted the Lord for his own salvation and deliverance. We can see that in verses 4 and 6 in Jonah 2. He trusted the Lord as his own salvation in verse 4 and 6. And he realized salvation was all of the free grace of God. As he says in verse 8, those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs. And God's grace is available to all who call upon God and not go to idols or their own schemes. And yet, incredibly, knowing all that, he put 1 and 1 = 16.5. Because he couldn't connect God's grace and mercy to himself going to other people. Why should the Ninevites have that? We noted last time, Jonah had this area of precious sin. That which he clung on to, that which dominated his thinking and affected his lives, it was exclusive Jewish nationalism, and it gave him an unbalanced and an incorrect view that salvation was only for the Jews. Only the Jews deserved God's goodness. Only the Jews deserved to be spared. It was for the ones who were the descendants of Abraham. In short, Jonah was filled with pride, exclusive spiritual pride. And his attitude was, we are fine. Whereas others, especially the Ninevites, they deserve to be destroyed. And his prevalence in his precious sin blinkered him, caused him to be short-sighted. In verse 2, he says literally as he complained to God, Is this not what I said when I was yet in my homeland? When I was back home, when I was there in Israel, the northern tribes, didn't I tell you that's why I didn't want to come? It's because you're a God that's gracious and compassionate. That must be the worst reason for not telling people the good news of God's grace and mercy, because God is good and kind and can forgive them. And it's easy to condemn Jonah, but we're to realize that we are all Jonahs. We all have that sort of inclination in us. We can see things our way. We can expect, we can demand silently at least, that things be done our way, according to our thoughts, according to what we want, and we think that those things are right. And it could be caused by all sorts of factors. And yet we too can react by resenting God's blessings on things not carried out in accordance with our views or our plans or our ways. And we can resent others who do not see and do things as we do. There's one way, it's the wrong way, and it's my way. And we can have that attitude. And yet God says, just see what I can do. I can surprise you. I can blow your little thoughts out of the water. But let's get back to Jonah. You see, we all have our own areas of prejudice and weakness, which we will react to almost in an unthinking way. These reactions can even spill over into our attitude and in our approach to God. Our Christianity seems fine in theory, but we're not prepared to put it into action because it cuts across our pet prejudices and our biases. God's word comes and challenges us. Have we got our own fixed ideas that we're not going to budge from because that's the way I've always believed, that's the way I think it should be done? And God is saying, but it goes against my character and my working. Jonah had his theology right, for he knew what God was like. He even knew God's purpose in sending him to Nineveh, and yet it was not applied and it was not worked out in his life as his own ideas, as his own prejudices short-circuited the glorious things that he knew of God, and he misapplied God's dealings with him and with Nineveh. And he couldn't connect that he didn't deserve anything from God, neither did Nineveh, but God is a gracious and compassionate God. How are we affected by our biases, our ideas? Do we test them by God's word? Do we twist God's word to fit our ideas? Anyway, let's note three main things from Jonah's complaint. And first of all, his praying. His praying. Jonah was hot and bothered, full of anger, full of resentment. But he didn't run away from God this time. But he prayed. That's a good thing to do, isn't it? Would you call Jonah's prayer a prayer? He remonstrates at best. He flies at God with a list of complaints. Even God's character is brought into it and aspersions cast against it. He complains about what God has done. I wonder how many of us would be honest to say that we have come like this to God in prayer. God, why didn't you let that work out? God, why did you bring that into my life, into the life of the church, into the life of the family, the life of the nation, or whatever? We go to God and we mourn in bitterness and resentment, and we arrogantly told God what he was doing along, allowing or not allowing such and such, not stepping in and doing as we expected, as we planned, as we hoped. This is the second prayer we read of Jonah. It's only a small book, and we get two amazing prayers in it. The first was from inside the fish. And there's a great contrast between that prayer and this prayer. Obviously, there's the location, the belly of the fish, and sat outside Nineveh in the sunshine. In the first, he cried to the Lord in need. But here, he cries to God in anger. The first was in humility and in need, and he cries out humbly. But this one is in carnal pride. God, what do you think you're doing? You know, I know better than you almost. In the first, he was empty of self. But here in Nineveh, he is full of self. In the first, he justifies God that God was right in doing this to him. And he accuses self. But here, he justifies self and he accuses God. You know, this isn't really a prayer. This is slandering God in so many ways. There's a similarity in both prayers. For in both, he is desperate. In the first, he's desperate to live. In the second, he's desperate to die. We have to say that Jonah prays in what we would term the wrong spirit. He doesn't have the right attitude of prayer. He seems to lecture God. He seems to make excuses for his sin and even blame God for God's goodness. We would never pray like that, would we? Would we really? Do we think we can kid ourselves that we would never pray in this way? Well, Well, if we did, we'd feel justified in doing so. And if we did, then, well, it was the right thing to do anyway. You see, we can have that attitude. God would understand anyway, can be our excuse. That things weren't going right, and I was just out of sorts. And yet we can pray like a Jonah. And we can do things like this. You see, we need to pause a moment and realize that even our greatest, our highest, our most noble prayers are tainted with sin. We can only approach God because we've got a Savior who's there in the presence of God. And He even purifies our sins as they come to the throne of grace. And there we find mercy and grace to help us in need. We can have our most noble prayers, even those that are tainted by sin, even when they've got tears of genuine repentance. We can still come sinfully into God's presence in prayer because we've got things that we want and we must have. And we'd almost say to God, you've got to answer this or else. You see, prayer is not a case of getting the right formula or feelings and hey presto, the answers drop down like a slot machine. It's not that at all. God hears and answers prayer because we have a relationship with Him, as we've seen on Sunday mornings just recently. And God is long-suffering. He's patient. And He puts up with us and all our pride and all our selfishness and our sin and our moaning and our complaining and our grumbling. And we call them prayers. You see, our prayers can so easily have an essence or perhaps even a fuller flavor of Jonah's prayer. And we can be guilty as Jonah of telling God what must be done and we're having a good old moan and complaint. Jonah here, because he felt that he had such great wisdom and insight, told God what was wrong with the situation. Jonah could not accept it and he seems to almost lecture God. There's a world of difference between not understanding a situation and we're confused and we're hurt and our heads seem to be spinning and we seem to be being sucked down a whirlpool of our own making that's happening in our own lives and we can't understand the situation. And it's right to say to God, God, why is this happening? I can't understand it. You know, help me in this moment to understand what you're achieving and give me strength and grace. And that's great. As we come and we submit to God and ask for the wisdom and the guidance and the understanding. But on the other hand, we can so easily charge God with injustice or a lack of love or you've abandoned me and this, that, and the other. And we're just complaining to God. We can do that so easily when things don't go according to our plans. When it's not easy. Because things don't go as we expected or planned them. It hurts our pride, our sense of dignity, our sense of worth. Now, and we can so easily fool ourselves into thinking that we're reacting in a right way to God, and especially to others, and we'll call that righteous indignation when they say something, and well, it's going to be righteous indignation. It's just a posh word for saying, I'm really angry with you, and we try and justify it. It's not good for any of us to pray in anger. That's why the Bible says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. You know, because none of us know at any time whether the person we're angry with, it could be the person we get into bed with, as it were, if it's a husband-wife situation, a family member or whatever, we don't know whether they or we'll be alive in the morning. Don't let the sun go down on our anger. Get it sorted out. Remember an old couple and they're talking and they said one time we had an argument. We married, you know, a number of years, and they had an argument, and they got to bed, nothing said. They walk into the bedroom, and the wife says, well, he says, yeah, we'll have to, won't we? So they knelt down beside the side of the bed and said, well, I can't pray either. Then they sorted out, then they were able to both pray together. That's a good time. Think about going to bed unable to pray, makes a difference. You can sleep far easier. Anyway, let's move on. Jonah, because he not only complained in his praying, but he also, secondly, justified his earlier rebellion. All that he'd done when he ran away from God, when he was up there, and he's headed off to Tarshish. Jonah is ready to justify his past misdeeds, as any one of us can be. Oh, well, you've got to understand, God, it's because, and we give our list of reasons. Jonah, in justifying himself to God, explained why he was disobedient previously. He said, basically, there, I told you so. It's because you're a good God, and I didn't want to go and tell this good news to them and let them have forgiveness. He's blaming God for his sin. Does that make his sin a bigger sin? That's your starter for five. There was Jonah telling God in his complaining prayer that he was justified in obeying, in disobeying him. He was using his present circumstances to justify past obedience. That God, I knew it was wrong, but I knew what you were like, and so I did that. It's strange that he didn't use such when he's talking to the sailors. And he didn't use such when he's in praying to God in the middle of the fish, in the fish's belly. No, he didn't mention those things then, but now he's on terra firma and he's sat outside the big city of Nineveh and he feels safe and secure. Now he tells God, I told you this. Here's Jonah, and he used human reason alone in arguing with God. I knew you would spare them. I knew you'd be kind. I knew you'd show them grace and mercy, and that's why I ran away. Surely you can see that. He was out of concern that they weren't saved. Can you imagine any Christian saying that? I'm not going to witness. I'm not going to live a Christian life because I'm concerned that people might be saved. He sidelined. He completely ignored the principle of obedience to God and his commands. You can go and do great things for God, but if you're not doing it in obedience to him and doing God's work in God's way, then you could be walking into trouble. He ignored the mercy of God in sparing him when he had run away. He ignored God not only sparing him, but then recommissioning him to go as his prophet to suit his own ends. Jonah twisted circumstances and even abused the goodness of God. He almost accuses God of error. God, you've got it wrong. That he made a mistake. It's Jonah saying, look, God, can't you see you've got it wrong and I've got it right? And yet none of us would, I hope none of us would dare to say that to God in prayer. This was the outworking of sin in this man of God. And we need to realize that sin will still dog our tracks. It will still be there in our midst. We're still in the human body, the body that the Bible calls so often the flesh. It's not just the meat and the muscles and all that about us. It talks about the sinful flesh. It's talking about that which is magnetically, gravitationally attracted to sin and sinful ways, that's so easily influenced by our old nature, our fallen nature. Even though we're new creatures in Christ spiritually, we've got this battle going on within us. There was this outworking of sin in this man of God. And we have to realize that sin can work itself out in us also. We can hang on to personal prejudices, our personal sins. We can even be prepared to tear heaven to pieces and tear God's word apart just to keep a little tiny bit of our precious sin in our life. Because when I do that, I feel good. It makes me happy. I'm content. And sadly, we like Jonah, we will dethrone God and enthrone self as being in charge of our lives. For sin always does that. And will always excuse itself. It will always excuse itself. We'll always have an excuse why we sinned, why we fell, why we went against God. Are any of us ready to excuse our wrongdoing, either by past or present circumstances in our lives? As much as we want to shift the blame, we're to realize that we are still personally accountable to God, the judge of all mankind. We're accountable for God for that which we have done, especially that which is wrong towards God. And as Jonah sought to justify his earlier rebellion, we're to see that he does see what he does, because thirdly, he reproaches God's character. He reproaches God's character. He puts a slander on God's character. Jonah recited that he knew of God and his character. And what he said was good and true Bible truth, good theology. But he did so with a coldness of heart. And he used it to reproach God. He turned that which is good and right, then he turned around and he said to God, I know that you are a God of compassion and long-suffering. And that's why I didn't want to come. But you sent me anyway. And I've just gone on a fool's errand. And they've all been saved and whatever. And they've turned back to God. And he said those things about God's graciousness and his compassion and his love. And it didn't seem to affect him one little bit. And this can happen to us. We can speak of God. We can speak of God's amazing love, it being shown in so great a salvation that he's provided, and that we've come to know that love, and we've come to know that forgiveness, and we've come to know God, this relationship with God, and we've experienced it personally. And yet we can remain untouched by the love of God, and we may even be able to recite all that, and we can remain unsaved. And even believers who've known and personally entered into this relationship with God, and we know a great deal about him, and yet with knowing all the love of God towards us, we can fail to show the same love to other people, whether they're Christians or whether they're non-Christians. People can have an attitude that the theory is fine, but don't expect me to show that love. Don't expect me to have time for people. Don't expect me to have those who, well, they're a different class to me. I mean, do you know what they do? Do you know what they say? And all they need is someone to sit down and just tell them more about Jesus. And you could see their lives transformed. And you don't even know that because you're just keeping your distance. Keep back. I'm too good to talk to you. You're below me. They don't show God's love and patience and long-suffering. And sometimes we can do it with other Christians because they upset me once, or they're not my type of person, or whatever. You see, Jonah's prejudices blinded his eyes to see the purpose of God to the Jews and the Gentiles. From Jonah's point of view, God should only have been merciful to the people of Israel, those who were his covenant people, those who had a great history with God. Because if he did so to the people of Nineveh, then God was not being God. He wasn't being just. He should just punish them. How on earth or in heaven could God ever be kind to those, must have been Jonah's understanding. How can God be kind to the Ninevites, the cruel, barbaric nation? They're oppressing Israel. They've been a pain in the neck for so long with Israel at this time. And yet Jonah failed to read God's word correctly. Or he read God's words selectively, and he missed God's purposes to bless all the nations through his people Israel. They were to be a light to the nations. People were to look at Israel and say, that's the kind of God we want. That's the kind of king we want to rule over, someone who's kind and he shows God's kindness and God's grace and God's mercy and God's wisdom. And we want this God to be our God. Yes, the fullness of the blessing of the Gentiles was still to some time off in the future. But the time would come when the blessings of God, the salvation that he provided, would go out to all nations. You read Psalm 117, just two little verses, and the psalmist there is just bursting with missionary work. Praise the Lord, all you nations. You know, call upon him. Come and see the great things he'd done. Come to know his loving kindness and his mercy. He's saying to the nations, come over and see how great our God is. And that's what we should be saying. Is we to realize that it's not just in the New Testament that God would reach out to the nations, but in the Old Testament, God was reaching out. And Nineveh would be one of those nations or one of those people who would rejoice in receiving God's grace and mercy. And sadly, Jonah objected to it, and he couldn't take it in. I know many Christians say, and to say honestly, that they had no idea why God ever saved them, why God had mercy on them. Either they were very moral and were living thoughtlessly without God, or just doing religious things and that was enough, or they'd sunk into the gutter and doing vile things, and yet they could say, I don't understand why God saved me. I don't like myself, they sometimes say. Why should God ever love me and set his love upon me and bring me to know his salvation? They can't understand. You see, the glorious gospel truth is that God's salvation is for whosoever will believe on him through the Lord Jesus Christ. And God makes that offer freely and truly to whosoever will hear, will listen, and will obey his command and take this great offer. It's offered freely and genuinely in the preaching, in the telling of the gospel, in the reading of the gospel, in the considerations of what Christ has done in his life and his ministry, his death, his resurrection and ascension. And do we realize that? We've got an amazing gospel. If one of us could be cooking something and we notice that it doesn't smell quite right and you're feeling ill because you've just gone down with COVID, but you want to do something nice for family members should they come and see you. And as you touch the batter or whatever, and suddenly you're made well, and here you have the cure for COVID or cancer or something like that. You're not going to say, oh, that's brilliant. I'll put it in the cupboard. You tell people, wouldn't you? You want people to know. Look, do you realize you've got this disease? I've got the cure. They might call you a crank. Well, just try it. And it works. And they want to tell others. To tell the gospel has been described as a blind beggar telling other blind beggars where to get food. And that's all we're doing. We're not saying we're better than you, because we realize how bad we are before we even go to Jesus. And as we recognize that, we should desire to tell others. For if this God was able to save us, then what he's done for us, he can do for others. It's that old song, isn't it? Just trying to think of how it goes. It is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he can do for you. With arms wide open, he'll welcome you. It is no secret what God can do. And so if anyone listening tonight here or online, realize that God can save you. You have to go to him. It's no secret. God can change your life, and he'll change it for the better. And I encourage you to seek God even this night. See, there may be things in our life that we might have reason to complain about, to mourn about, to be bitter and angry about. And if so, just pause a moment and just consider God's graciousness and God's abounding love and mercy in this so great salvation that he offers, that he's given to so many of us here in this building. Here, I know people watching online, he's given it to you as well. You see, we're not to remain angry, and we're not to remain bitter against God, but we're to taste and see that the Lord is good. We're to go back to him and realize that our God is a good God. He's good in every fiber of his being. There's no fault, there's no blemish, there's no bitterness, there's no rancor in him. He is good through and through. And what we need to know and what we need to have is the medicine of the sweetness of his love. As a lot of you know, I love honey. If I get a chance to try a different type of honey, I'll try a different chance at a different type of honey and then try and buy it. But we've got to taste and keep on tasting the sweetness of God's love. Because out of the strong comes sweetness, as Samson alluded to after he killed a lion and had honey. You'll find still the same words. Out of the eater came forth. I've forgotten it now, trying to quote it. Anyway, right. Now look it up. Buy Tate and Lyle syrup. And if you don't use it, then bring it down to our house. It'll do as well. But you see, God's love is being worked out in our lives. As we look back, we'll see all the way my Savior led me. He guided us. He kept us. He's doing it in love because he cares for us. We're his children if we're Christians. And we'll see the goodness of God affecting our lives, that even those hard times, they strengthened us. They developed us. And they're going to help us to be effective in our lives as we serve him, as we go on for him on a daily basis. For those of us who are Christians, never excuse sin. Never justify sin, especially by accusing God of being the reason why we did so. When we sin, it's because we're led astray by our lusts and our desires, and we go our own way and not God's way. When we find ourselves in that situation, we're to humbly come back to God, get down off our proud pedestals of pride, and seek the Lord to be in control of all areas of our life. My old pastor used to say, because in South Wales, a long time ago when I was a lad, and they were talk of having a parlour. The parlour, or the front room, was the best room. No one ever went in the front room. you know, except when the vicar came or the minister of the chapel came and he went in and the kids were all in bed and, you know, out of the way so they couldn't suspect that the kids were noisy or dirty or would cause trouble. And they always took the guests, important guests, into the parlor. And my old pastor used to say, many people allow God into the parlor, but not into the kitchen, not into the back rooms. And people do that. They keep God conveniently in a little safe place in their life, not letting him affect every area of their life. But we're to do that. We're to allow him to come into our life. And then we're to desire to tell others. Ask him for help to do so. Ask him for opportunities and for us to be wise, to be able to take those opportunities and to graciously do so. So we can tell others of our lovely Savior. And do so not because we must, but because we want others to know. Everybody ought to know is another song. We're not going to do that one either. But everybody should hear about our Savior and the great gospel. And we're to desire to have this yearning, these desires to tell this God. And pray that God would save as many as he did in Nineveh. 120,000, just those who can't tell their left hand from their right hand. Are they children? Are they just the children, the little ones in the city? Was the city much bigger than that? Some say it could have been 1 million, 2 million in number. Pray that God would do great things. We need our hearts filled with graciousness and compassion. That which we have experienced in God, that he would come and work in us and that he would work through us so that we could tell others of our great and our lovely Savior and that they too will come to know him. Right, let's finish there, and we're going to close by singing that God's mercy is more.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Sins there are many, his mercy is more. What love could remember, no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their son. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Constantly wrong. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you, the great, pure, holy God of heaven, you could look and you can see the full extent of our sins. And yet, Lord, from east to west, you have set our sins far from us. Lord, that you choose to never remember our sins again. Lord, and we thank you that though our sins, they are so many, infinite offenses against you, Lord, your love and your mercy and your grace is far greater. And Lord, far more than our sins could ever touch upon. And so, Lord, we thank you that you've brought us by your Son, the Lord Jesus, his blood shed. Lord, you granted us faith, you've worked in us, and Lord, we are your children. And Lord, may we know your joy, your peace, and your comfort as we go to our homes now. We ask it for your glory and for your honor. Amen.